Shaka Singor will always bear the title convicted felon.
At the age of 19, I shot and killed a man.
But of course, his life didn't start out that way.
You were an honor roll student. What happened?
Once I started going through the things at home, like I just stopped taking an interest in school. And it's one of the things, like now when I look back, especially working with a lot of young people, I think about how we sometimes fail as adults to really pay attention to what's happening to children. Because I literally went from honor roll student to like barely showing up in class.
You say no one ever stopped to say, what's wrong?
Yeah.
Why are your grades falling off? Not one person?
Not one person. Originally, it felt like kind of like the ideal black middle class family. A lot of siblings, a lot of fun times, but also a lot of very hurtful and painful times. Dealing with the abuse of my mother and dealing with the disillusion of my parents' marriage.
He served 19 years, 7 of them in solitary confinement.
You knowingly chose the street life. Yeah. No one pushed you there. Nothing forced you there. Why did you choose it?
Well, I was looking for love and acceptance. And I ran away when I was 14 years old. And, you know, I was naive like most 14-year-olds and thought that somebody's parent would take me in and shelter me from the abuse. But that didn't happen. And so when I got introduced to the drug trade, it came under the guise of love and acceptance. And when you're a young, vulnerable teenager who has been hurt and damaged, you're looking for that type of emotional connection to anybody that's saying, hey, I love you and I have you back, you're back. And so I chose that lifestyle.
You felt accepted there.
I felt accepted, definitely.
He sold crack by age 14, was shot himself at 17, and murdered a man by 19 in a drug deal gone awry.
I realized that not only had I tragically caused somebody's death, but that I devastated somebody's family, and that I couldn't take that back. I got a letter from my son while I was on that 4.5-year stint in solitary. And in the letter, he wrote me and he said, dear Dad, I know you were in prison for murder. Please, Dad, don't kill again. Jesus watches what you do. As a father, I realized that I had not only failed my son, but that I was failing a whole generation of young men who had grown up in the neighborhood. I realized that I needed to do something different with my life. Mm-hmm. And first thing was taking full responsibility for the decisions I made that landed me in prison, but also to figure out a way how I can utilize that experience to help other young men and women avoid the path that I had taken.
The aunt of the man Singor murdered wrote him a letter of forgiveness while he was serving time. She told me she loved him because God loved him.
I think a lot of viewers watching this will ask, you are a former felon, a murderer, you took a man's life. Why should people listen to you now?
Because I think in order to solve a problem, you have to be as in closest proximity to it as possible. And the reality is that, you know, gun violence is a large part of what's happening in American society. And who better to understand how to solve that than somebody who's going through it? When you look at our criminal justice system, if you haven't been in there, you can't really tell somebody what needs to be done to turn it around. The last time I was in solitary confinement was 23-hour lockdown, 5 days a week, 24-hour lockdown, the other 2 days of the week. And it was transformative on many levels because, for one, I realized that something was terribly wrong with our system. But the level of barbarity and dehumanizing behavior that exists in solitary confinement was shocking to my conscience.
In Righting My Wrongs, Singor asks the central question. How do you emerge in a society that is so unforgiving?
There is a lot of discussion right now in Washington about prison reform. Are you hopeful?
I'm very hopeful. I think that we're at a space now where the American public is a lot more aware, because I feel like, you know, if you're footing the bill for this and to not get the return on investment that's been promised to us, I think it's really unfair. And our prison system currently operates as one big warehouse.
A warehouse?
Yeah, a warehouse. Yeah, a warehouse of misery, to be specific. And so the reality is, either you can help them, you can further hurt them, and then you can wake up and say, okay, I'm not surprised that they get out and come back. And so I think that politicians for years have lied to the American public with the war on drugs and the fear-based campaign of let's be tough on crime. And they've said, well, we'll lock him up and throw away the key. But the reality is 90% of people incarcerated will get out.
A 2014 study from the Bureau of Justice Statistics followed inmates from 30 states for 5 years. It found nearly 70% of former prisoners returned to prison within 3 years of being released.
American society, we have a choice in what kind of men and women we want to return. So either you want healthy men and women who are ready to re-enter society, be as contributing members of society, or you want broken men and women who's going to come out and wreak havoc on society.
Today, he works with the Cut 50 Initiative, a bipartisan effort to reduce the U.S. prison population by half by 2025.
Who's your biggest ally in this fight?
We have multiple allies, surprisingly. Newt Gingrich has been a great ally. A lot of people from the Republican Party and, you know, different politicians. So, you know, I just think it's a time in the country where everybody is realizing that we've done this thing wrong for a long time. I mean, in 1994, President Clinton passed a crime bill. Prison population exploded as a result of that bill. Extremely harsh sentences for crimes that didn't really warrant that.
Three strikes, you're out.
Three strikes, you're out. The removal of higher education in prison, even though it was proven that those who come out educated are less likely to go back. I was averaging a 4.0 when they took college out. And so I didn't get an opportunity to get my degree.
House Speaker Paul Ryan said recently he would bring legislation to the floor of the House to amend criminal sentencing laws. Mm. What's your reaction to that?
I think it's great. I mean, I think if you think about what the cornerstone is of faith, is forgiveness and redemption. And I think that when we look at our country, that's the foundation of the country, is built on faith, different faiths. And no matter what faith you come from, background you come from, that's a deep part of that. And sadly, it hasn't been extended to those who are incarcerated.
Are you an anomaly?
I don't think so. We're throwing away a lot of greatness. We're basically dismissing people's humanity. And I think we fail considerably when it comes to young, specifically inner city kids. We're quick to throw them away. We're quick to judge them more harshly than other kids are judged. It's the reality of the racial dynamics and the class dynamics in America. We're not always honest about that.